Yeah. Let's see, waarom hebben we nou het zonder dat we van de zon kunnen meten?
I think we can start. Welcome to everybody to this new evening event. And as a first speaker, I would like to introduce Farshad Ramazani. He's a PhD student in our department, pharmaceutics. And as you know, one of the biggest topics in our department is to try to improve the performance of challenging drugs with the smart formulations. And one of these approaches, for example, loading them in microparticles. And Farshad has been busy with this, I think, for enough time to give a very interesting presentation. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you so much, Anna, for the nice introduction. In today's presentation, I would like to talk about formulation of sunitinib into polymeric microparticles for ocular drug delivery. I'm sure none of you likes to receive injection into his or her eyes. Or if you have to do so, you would prefer to decrease the number of injection as low as possible, perhaps once or two times per year, not every day or every week. Why do we need injection like intravitreal injection? Because of different biological barrier in the eyes, the topically applied drugs, such as eye drops, cannot reach the posterior segment of the eye, the backside of the eye, where most of the eye diseases happen. So we need a delivery system to increase the concentration of the drug in the backside of the eyes. In this case, we can do that with the intravitreal injection, or we can improve this one with the formulation of sustained release formulation that is the topic of this study. You see here in this picture a schematic picture of a normal eye. When light comes through the cornea, it will get focused by the lenses of the eye. The light further goes to the retina, where the photoreceptors are there. The image can be further processed by the optic nerve to the brain. It will be transmitted to the brain, and the brain will interpret the image, and that's why we can see things. But in case of no vascular diseases, you'll have a high rate of angiogenesis in the retina, and especially in the macula, which is the central part of the retina. The unwanted growth of blood vessels in this area will impair your vision. You will see a dark spot in your view, in your vision. And by grossing the blood vessels, the dark spot can be further grown. And at the end, if you don't stop the progress of the blood vessel and angiogenesis there, unfortunately, it will lead to the permanent blindness. So it's important to do something here. The overexpression of VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor, I'm sure most of you are familiar with this protein. It's a stimulating protein, signaling protein, which is responsible for angiogenesis and neovascularogenesis of many diseases, such as age-related macular degeneration, diabetic retinopathy, retinal vein occlusion, which are all have high rate of angiogenesis in the eye, in the posterior segment. The current treatment is based on antibodies which can stop the, which can bind to the VEGF and stop the stop this protein from further working. One of them is ranibizumab, which is a which is a kind of antibody, and the other one is pegapeptinib, which is a small interfering RNA. Both of them have been approved by FDA for intravitreal injection every 6 weeks. They can and they could slow down the progress of the disease. However, further treatment, further improvement is needed in this field, especially with the formulation which can sustain the activity of drug within the posterior segment of the eye. Sunitinib is a small molecule, multi-targeted tyrosine kinase inhibitor, which has highest affinity to VEGF receptors, and it blocks the activity of VEGF. It's been approved by FDA for the treatment of gastrointestinal stromal tumor, as well as renal cell carcinoma. And it shows good activity in a preclinical study for to stop the growth of blood vessels in the eye. However, sunitinib has some adverse effects ranging from mild hand-foot syndrome to life-threatening cardiac toxicity. The tolerability of sunitinib can be further improved by local administration of the drug, thereby increasing the concentration of the drug in the site of action and decreasing the drug distribution to the surrounding tissues. So the aim of this study is to encapsulate sunitinib into polymeric microparticles. For those who are not familiar with the microparticles, they are drug delivery devices which can extend and prolong the release of and the activity of drug for a longer period of time, from weeks to months. It depends on the formulation and the polymer that you use and the disease that you want to treat. And the other advantages of this system is that they are injectable. So you can, using normal syringe, you can inject them in the targeted organ. In this case, in the eye. And we are aiming for having a sustained release formulation which can release the drug for a long period of time by administration of injection of the particles within the vitreous body and thereby suppressing the angiogenesis there. In this presentation, I will further explain how we synthesize the polymers, some physical chemical characteristics of the polymer that we used, formulation of sunitinib into polymeric microparticles, some degradation and release study of the prepared particles, and then I will show you some angiogenesis study, and finally I will summarize the talk and future plan and some discussion. Okay. For the polymers, we, in collaboration with the InnoCore, we synthesize a group of multiple copolymers. Consists of a hard or crystalline block and a soft or amorphous blocks. Briefly, we first made the prepolymers by normal standard ring opening polymerization. So we synthesized a short D-lactide, tag D-lactide, and also a L-lactide using BDO, which is a short alcohol. Then the polymers were further chain extended using a urethane linkage to build up the final multiple copolymers. We synthesized three different composition, polymer A, B, and C. Polymer A has 10% of the soft block. Polymer B has 20% of the soft block, and polymer C has 30% of the soft block, and the rest is the semi-crystalline hard block. The composition of polymer is important because we can tune the degradation and the release of particles, the drug from the particles at the end. a little bit about the physicochemical characteristic of the polymers. We perform a thermal analysis study using DSC. For those who are not familiar with DSC, it's a machine that you put your samples, you have a reference, and it gives you a graph based on the as a function of temperature and time. So you heat up from here, in this case, from minus 80, we heat up the samples. It gives you a transition and changes in the temperature up to the 210, I think we increase the temperature here in this case. So what we got from DSC is that we have a semi-crystalline polymer because we have a TG, which is a glass transition, because the polymer are solid. If you heat them in a certain range of temperature, they start to become rubber or semi-solid, let's say. So this transition called glass transition or TG is one of the characteristics of amorphous material. The melting point is the characteristic of the crystalline material, and we have both of them, and it's showing that we have a semi-crystalline material. The TG is, is decreasing by increasing the amount of soft block in the polymer, and it's known because of the PEG, which is plasticizing, which has a plasticizing effect and decreasing the TG of polymer. We further show that the crystallinity of the polymer is because of parapolymer polylactide, L-lactide. As you might know, PEG is a semi-crystalline polymer. And you see here in the X-ray study, we do see a peak of PEG and polylactide parapolymer. However, we don't see the peaks of PEG in the final multiplier copolymers, but we do see the peak of polyethylene. So the crystallinity of the polymer is for the PLA, and the PEG become amorphous in the final multiplier copolymer. For preparation of microparticles, we used a single emulsion method. If you are not familiar with the emulsion, you can also see here, but I suppose most of you are familiar with the basic emulsion. We dissolved the drug in DMSO. We added it to the polymer solution in dichloromethane. So this is our organic phase. We add the organic phase to the water, consists of emulsifier under high speed homogenization. The particles are formed here. And in this stage, we have an emulsion, and the organic phase start to be extracted from the primary particles to form a final microparticle, drug-loaded microparticles. So we ended up with a suspension consisting of our drug-loaded particles. They are big enough. We can use centrifugation to separate the particles for further analyzing. In this table, you see the characteristics of particles that we made. The size was about 30 micrometer in all cases. We got the high yield and also high encapsulation efficiency, especially for particles made of polymer A and B. With polymer C, we got quite low encapsulation efficiency. I have to mention that polymer C had highest amount of soft block. The soft block, which was consist of D-lactide and PEG. PEG is water soluble and it can absorb water. And during the formulation, because we have a emulsion system, the water can, the particles can absorb water and the drug can diffuse out of the particles. So we got low encapsulation efficiency. I have to mention that in our pilot study, we showed that because sunitinib is a kind of ionizable drug, it has a pKa of about 9. We showed that the encapsulation efficiency is highly dependent on the pH. And we increased the pH of external water phase to a pH of 9, and thereby ensuring drug, sunitinib in this case, to have no net charge or at least have less charge, and then improving the loading efficiency of the drug. I didn't show the result of that because of the time. We further performed some degradation study by incubation of fraction of particles in PBS 37 degrees. And during different time points, we analyzed the particles. And as you see here in this picture, the microweight of particles, polymer, is decreasing right after incubation during the time up to 210 days of this study. And it is the case for the dry mass of particles. And the decrease in the microweight and dry mass of particles also is the line with the amount of soft block that we have in the polymer. So if you have higher amount of soft or PEG content block, you will have higher rate of degradation. We further analyzed the degraded product during the time using NMR study to show that indeed the PEG is decreasing. And what we saw in this study is that at the initial phase of study, the PEG loss was quite significant for polymer C and then polymer B, and we did not see any PEG change in the polymer A, which had lowest amount of soft block up until about 150 days. But further after that, we saw a decrease in the PEG content. This is the ratio between PEG and DL-lactide, I have to say. In this picture, you see the scanning electron microscopy images of the microparticles before incubation in the release medium. So they are all spherical with polydispersity, which is due to the method that we used with the ultra thorax, and you don't have a control over the size. After 9 weeks of incubation, the particles are still spherical. You don't see that much change in the structure of the particles. However, after 30 weeks of incubation, in case of polymer with lowest amount of soft block, we don't see that much change. Polymer with the middle amount of soft block, we do see some changes in the particles, degraded product, damaged particles, especially in polymer C, we do see totally damaged particles. And most importantly, the release of particles. You see in this graph the cumulative percent of drug release versus time of incubation. For the polymer A with lowest amount of soft block, we do see a quite nice zero order drug release. And up until 210 days of study, it's a quite long study. And till this time, about 40% of drug is released. Case of polymer B, the drug start to release in a kind of sustained manner as well. And the release was completed about 150 days. And it reached a plateau. In case of polymer C, with highest amount of PEG content, we do see a high initial burst, about 40% of the drug is released in the first day of incubation. It might be, in most cases, it's unwanted. You don't want that much of drug to be released in one day. However, the drug is released in a kind of sustained manner afterwards. To summarize the release and degradation study of these semi-crystalline microparticles, after incubation in the release medium, they absorb water. The particles can swell to some extent. It can increase the release of drug from the particles. After absorbing water, hydrolysis will happen. It decreases the microweight of polymer, and that hydrolysis can produce lactic acid in this case, which can further catalyze the hydrolysis of the polymer and at the end starting polymer erosion, and which can further increase the drug release from the particle. So At the end, the drug release from these particles is governed by the combination of diffusion and polymer erosion or degradation, which the degradation, which was at the same line of polymer composition. So by increasing the hydrophilicity of polymer, we had higher rate of degradation. To have an idea about the anti-angiogenic effect of the drug, we used a simple cheek chorioallantoic membrane assay. You see here in this picture, this is a chorioallantoic membrane, which is a extra embryonic membrane responsible for bringing nutrient and oxygen to the embryo up until the hatching of the embryo. This is due to having a dense network of blood vessels. It's a good model to study angiogenesis. It's also a quite validated model. We use this method, and we tested different formulation. We after and before applying the drug. So the first column in each line is, the first one is before applying the drug, and the second column is after applying. We had different groups, a group of PBS only, a group of blank microparticles, so we don't have a drug, and two different groups of free drug, free sunitinib, with two different concentrations, 50 nanogram and 100 nanogram, and the last one is the group of drug-loaded microparticles, which can release the drug, about 100 nanogram of drug during the first 24 hours of study. And we saw that the sunitinib, as well as drug-loaded microparticles, could indeed suppress the growth of blood vessels. And you see here in this representative picture before and after applying the drug. To summarize this study, I have to say that we successfully encapsulated sunitinib into polymeric microparticles with high encapsulation efficiency. The sunitinib microparticle could release the drug at least for 7 months, and the drug release and degradation of particles was depend on the percentage of soft to hard block of the multi-block copolymers. We perform a angiogenesis assay, and the particles could suppress the angiogenesis in a CAM assay. And in the future, we are aiming to perform a in vivo study in an in vivo model of age-related macular degeneration, and we are hoping to suppress the angiogenesis there and forever. At the end, I would like to thank many people who helped me during this study. People from Utrecht University, our department, and the other departments. From Inocor Pharmaceutical, from Aachen University, and Iranian Ministry of Health for the grant that they give me to perform this study. And of course, you for your great attention to this presentation, and I would like to also here, if you have any question or comment.
Thank you, Farshad, for this interesting presentation. Are there any questions? Shima.
Farshad, thanks for your presentation.